Okay, recording started. I'll go to present. Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think yesterday we saw till tax adding categories, right? Yeah. Yeah, we added yesterday in the part of demo, we created what we did yesterday. We created an organization table, then we created an authentication token, then we insert a tax table. Yeah, yes. We insert a tax table, category table. Now we need to add offer. Okay. Now here is offer table. Offer is a simple table only. It has offer code, offer name, offer description, status. These four columns is an important column in the offer table. For offer, we need to use this endpoint. We need to use this endpoint. Then we need to pass an authorization JWT token. If you invoke this offer, it never work because JWT is expired. Okay, already it's expired. Let me check. I think server is not started yet. I need to start the server. Yeah, server is started now. Yeah, it's giving a forbidden error because of this not a valid JWT token because it should expire now. We need to generate a JWT. I'm copying this. This offer request. Okay, I'm going to send a request now. Offer is created successfully. Okay. This is the offer response. After creating an offer, this is a response. If you look at the database, you can see here offer data get populated. The next step is we need to create a vendor. The next step is we need to create a vendor. Why we need to create a vendor? Vendor is nothing but it's a person who is can you please mute someone? I think someone is not muted. When vendor store the user information, that vendor user type is a manufacturer or wholesale retailer. If you want to sell some product, we need to buy the products from the wholesale retailer, right? That wholesale retailer information we need to maintain inside a vendor table. Okay. If you look at the vendor table, this is a vendor table. Here we have a full name, vendor code, user ID. User ID is coming from user table. In that user table, we have some common information of user vendor data. The vendor specific information we need to maintain inside a vendor table. Okay. I think still people are joining. Now we need to, whenever you purchase a product, whenever you buy a product from the manufacturer, that manufacturer information we need to maintain in the vendor table. Okay. If you want a lot of product, first we need to buy the product from the manufacturer. That manufacturer information we need to load inside the vendor. For that, we need to populate a vendor data now. This is a vendor request. This is the vendor request. You look at here, we have inside a vendor, we have a user object. User type, email, password, and the first name, last name, mobile number, then that vendor address, everything available here. Okay. In the vendor level, I have maintaining only one data called is full name. If you need any additional information, we can add in future in the vendor table. Okay, as of now, I have only one column called full name and a vendor code. There is another column called vendor code. That's it. That is a unique code for that particular vendor. This is a request we need to pass to the server. Now we need to take the JWT token. Header. Created, 201 created. Vendor table got populated. The user ID is 2, right? When you look at the user ID, see the vendor name is Surya Prakash and user ID is 2. See, this is the user ID 2, surya@mnc.com. Then first name Surya and last name is Prakash. That is available here, Surya Prakash. Then user ID is 2. Check here, user ID is 2. Okay, now vendor is populated. Then if you look at the address table, vendor address get populated there. Vendor address, what is the user ID? The user ID is a 2, right? Vendor user ID is a 2. That corresponding user ID gets added here, the new row created. Okay, now we populate the vendor. Next step is whatever product we bought from that vendor, that product information we need to store in purchase order table. There is a one table called purchase order. The next step is we need to load the data in purchase order, right? See vendor one, after filling the vendor data, we need to create a purchase order. After populating a purchase order, then only I can add a product to the product table. Based on this purchase order information, our API look at this purchase order table. Based on that information, it will load automatically product inside a product table and a product item table. Okay. Now we're going to call an API for purchase order. I am copying the JWT token, the header, I am passing that. I want to explain about this request definitely. Okay, what is the request? This is a purchase order request. I got one product name, T-shirt -40 ice cream size. This is the product name, unique. Okay, then product description. Product description can be anything. Product name must be a unique. Then quantity. I got 10 product, 10 t-shirts from this particular manufacturer, from the manufacturer. Each the t-shirt unit price is 300. That is one t-shirt rate is a 300. Then purchase order status I am sending as a ready. Then vendor. Which vendor we got this t-shirt? That vendor ID we need to pass. See, we have only one vendor here. That ID is a 1. So we need to pass that vendor ID. Then tax information. So we are buying a t-shirt, right? For t-shirt, tax information I already loaded here. See, tax ID is a 1. HSN code is a 6109. Tax description, then tax percentage. I want to pass this tax ID here. So this tax ID mapping to particular HSN code, this HSN code mapping into the tax percentage. This tax percentage applied to this particular product. Whenever buy the product, this that particular tax percentage applied to that particular product. Then category, we need to say which category it is. In the category table, I have only one row. There's a category ID, category code, then menswear, name is menswear. I want to pass this category ID in this request. Now I am passing the product name, product description, how much I bought from that particular vendor, then unit price, then vendor ID, tax ID, then category ID. This information I need to pass, we need to pass in the purchase order request. Okay. Now I am sending the request. See the table before I want to show the table. See, it does not have any data here. See, 201 created. We got the response. When you refresh the table, see, we got the data here. Product name, that t-shirt-40 size, product description, unit price, quantity, total amount is calculated automatically. 300, the total amount is 300. For what is the GST for that? GST automatically calculating. And for this tax ID, GST is a 5%, right? For so it's calculating the 5% GST and put the tax amount as a 150. The total amount is a grand total 3150. Who is the vendor? Vendor ID is a 1. What is the category? Category is a 1. Status equal to 2. Status equal to 2, nothing but it's a ready state. Whenever any product is a ready state, then only we can load this product to the product table. Otherwise, we cannot load. In the code base, you can see here. There is a static data. There is one package called static data. In the static data package, I am maintaining all the enums. When you look at here, purchase order status, pending, initiated, ready and completed. I want to use this many status, but as of now I want to go with the by default ready status. Okay. I will pass this enum object while saving the purchase order as a ready. That is the reason it gives the 2 here. The first one is a 1, 2. The 2 value, the ready is nothing but a 2. The 2 will be stored in status column. Okay, now we have created the purchase order successfully. Using this purchase order table, we need to load the product into the product table as well as a product item table. Okay. When you look at this screen, product and the product item is a table where we are maintaining the product item. All other tables, tax, category, offer, vendor, purchase order, all are dependent table of product table. Without these tables, we cannot load the product. Now, I want to tell what is the relation between product and the product item. See, product is a, when you look at here, In the purchase order, I got one product, right? That is the product name. The product name always unique. This product name data will be stored in the product table. This entire data automatically gets stored in product table. After storing the product table, I got 10 quantity, right? 10 t-shirt, I got it from this particular vendor. So that means 10 quantity, 10 items. In that product, we have 10 items. In your godown, in your shop, there is a physically, you must have 10 products of this t-shirt. Okay, for the 10 product, I need to populate data in the product item. Since here 10, this product item create 10 kind of product item. Each product item mapped with this particular product ID, that is this particular product name, automatically generate. Okay, for each product item, it will generate a one barcode. It will generate a one barcode. That barcode, I call it as a product item code. Whenever populate the product table, it look at the purchase order table. Okay, quantity is a 10. Then system understand that for this product, we need to generate 10 different row, 10 different data in the product item table. For each product item, it will generate a unique product item code that we can consider as a barcode. Whenever you buy the product from the shop, they are going to scan, right? It will go on to scan the barcode. That barcode is nothing but a unique code. I am here call it as a product item. So once, now we're going to see now how to populate this. Now we have a generated data for all the dependent table. Only pending is we need to load the product table. Vaidheshwaran, too late. This is a product endpoint. I'll show the request. This is the product, to populate the product data, these are requests. It's a very small request. We have to say name. What is the name of the product? Then we have to tell what is the price of the product. We should not add the actual price here, right? We want to sell this product, so that we need to add more amount. So I'm adding as a 400. Here I bought it from vendor 300, but I want to sell one t-shirt as a 400. This vendor ID is to whom we bought. This is a manufacturer ID. That idea I'm going to pass it here. Whenever you send this request, our system will go and check. There is a product name like this, and that particular product must be ready status. Okay, if it is a ready status, it will generate the 10 different product item. Why? Because we are passing quantity as a 10, so it will go to generate 10 different product item in the product table, sorry, in the product item table. Now I'll go to send a request. So I need to copy the jet token. I got the response, success response. This is the response. See, the response is very big because we the product quantity is 10, right? So 10 different product items get generated in the product item table. When you look at the product item table, first we look at the product table. For product table, product got generated. For this product, since here is a stock count is 10, the product item table, it will generate 10 different product item. Each product item pointing to this product ID 1, because this is a product ID 1. Okay, now we have filled the data. We have set up the data. Now our billing system is ready to sell the product. Okay, now we need to sell. If you want to sell a product, here I am maintaining two tables, biller table and a payment table. I'm going to close all the table now. Any questions so far?
Hello. Sir, we are using a JWT token of which user now? Employee?
We are using that same employee, yeah, that this one. This user. This user.
Okay. So, okay, he's owner. And can vendor also add products? And...
No, vendor cannot add. Vendor cannot add. Vendor cannot add. Customer cannot add. Only that particular person can add.
Okay.
Actually, this is a multi-user. This is not a multi-user system. Okay. This is the intention of this product is I am adding. I am designing this product for only single user. Okay. Small little can use this. As of now, I am not focusing on roles part very much, but the system have a facility to restrict that users. Easily we can restrict. I have those configuration everything here.
Okay.
Yeah, tell me someone asked some question.
Do we have some, this table like configuration, how it is associated? Because, you know, have you some video where I can go through and understand? Because it's tables are little, you know, too much tables, so it is little confusing.
Yeah, I have I don't have a full set video, but whenever I develop some piece of functionality, right, that time I will explain that particular piece of functionality, what are the tables associated with the functionality. Like that video I have, okay, I will share that.
Okay.
Otherwise, I'll prepare one video. I'll send it to you.
Especially for these tables.
Yeah. Definitely. Especially for the tables, I'll prepare the video. I'll send it to you definitely. But meanwhile, I will check that there is some videos explaining about the tables. I will share that. Okay. Now there is a two table called payment and a biller. Where is biller? Yeah, it's a biller. We can see here the biller table, the biller bill number, customer ID, grand total, total tax amount, date created, date modified, bill status and the quantity. This is the parent table of payment table. Let's assume the scenario, you are going to purchase some product from the supermarket. You are not only purchasing one item, right? You may purchase multiple items. For example, you can purchase chocolate, you can purchase vegetables, you can purchase some drinks, okay? So, multiple product you may purchase from the shoppers. So, each individual product item maintained here, payment table, maintained in payment table. For example, I am purchasing vegetables. That vegetable information, for that vegetable information, 1 rupee created. I am purchasing one chocolate. For chocolate payment information, 1 rupee created here. I'm purchasing one soft drinks. That soft drinks payment information stored in the payment table. Okay. Then this total payment detail available in biller table. The biller table generate one bill number, one unique bill number for particular payments, for particular transaction. Here I purchase a three different item. For that three different item, there is a one bill number. That bill number available here. Then who is the owner of that bill number? That is the customer ID. That customer ID maintaining here. Then grand total of that bill. Then what is the total tax amount? What is the bill status? That quantity. That's it. It's a very simple table. Payments and a biller. This biller is a this payment table is each product item information. That is what is the product item ID you bought? What is that product price? It's a tax ID and a total price, tax amount, everything will be individual. It's information about the individual product item. Okay. Now we're going to send a request to make a payment. there is a request we need to send. Whenever, just imagine, whenever in the supermarket or some other shop, whenever product, whenever you buy a product, the people, that employee will scan the product. That scan data, these are the scan data, that barcode. That's a product item ID. This is a product item ID. Here I am calling it as a product code. Where is that? Yeah, here I am calling it as a product item ID only. Okay, product. This is a product item ID. Which product that particular employee scanned, that product information I am passing as an array object. Okay, then customer mobile number. Who is the customer? Most of the supermarket, when you go, they will ask mobile number, right? This is the mobile number. This is the customer mobile number. Then product, the customer purchasing. This is the product information, product item information. Okay. Only these two data we need to send. Whenever you send this request, this mobile number already available, already existing customer, it will go and create a sales for this customer. If this mobile number is not present, is a new customer, meaning on the fly, it will create a new customer, then create a sales for this customer in the payment table and the biller table. Okay. Now we'll going to see user table. The user table, we have only two data. One is a vendor, one is a owner. Okay, still there is no customer here. Also, the user table mapped with the customer table. Customer table also does not have any information. Okay. Similarly, payment billers as well as the payments. Now I want to send a request. Before sending request, please make sure that this ID is valid. Okay. Go to product item. There's a 10 product item. I want to buy. I want to scan first product item, testing here. Then last one. Here the mobile number, whatever I will going to say, 2222 something. Okay, created this the response, bill number generated, customer data generated, grand total, quantity 2, because I added only 2 product, right? That's the reason say quantity is a 2. Then total tax amount 40. Now we'll go into verify the database table. Customer table. Customer data populated. User ID is a 3. This is a customer code. When you look at the user table, user ID 3 is generated. User type is a customer. Now for this customer, one payment bill must generate. The customer ID is a 3, right? Look at the bill, biller table. See, customer ID is a, what is this? Oh, sorry. This user ID is a 3. I told wrongly. Here user ID is a 3. This user mapped with the one customer called customer ID 1. Customer ID is a 1. This customer mapped with the one user called user ID called 3. That user is available here. Okay, now this customer mapped with the biller table. That's the reason you're saying customer is a 1. Okay, then total tax amount 400, grand total is a 800, because I set a value 400, each t-shirt is a 400. Okay, so grand total 400, to a tax amount is a 40 for a 800 rupees. Then payment table, come to the payment table. I purchased 2 items. For the 2 items, 2 rows got created. Product item ID 10, product item ID 1. I have chosen first row, then last row, right? So product item 10 and the product item 1. When you look at the product item, see first row status changed to 1. That means sold. For the last row, 10th row, right? The 10th item also marked as a 1. That meaning the two products sold. Then price of the each individual item 400. And tax ID is 1. For this tax, tax percentage when you calculate come to 20 rupees. The total price is a 420. Payment status is a success. What is the product ID? Product ID is a 1. Okay. So we have completed the one sales. Sorry guys. So this is the order we followed, right? First we created the tax table, then first we created the organization, then generated the authentication, then created the tax category offer, then added the vendor, then added the purchase order, then load the product from the purchase order, then we'll sold the product using the biller table and the payment table. Any questions?
No, sir.
Okay. Actually, I want to cover this day two. I want to cover only the demo, but I completed before complete the meeting. Anyway, no problem. I'll going to start day three. What is that? Day three we have. Yeah, we need to explain about the what are all the features implemented in the in our billing system.
Sir, like, can you please show us the, like, you know, you did the mapping, right, in the database table, you know.
Yeah.
How did you know the mapping, you know, in the code, you know, source code? Can you please show us in, like?
Yeah, I will tell that tomorrow something. Like, first, field, whatever I plan, I'll complete. Definitely, there will be some time because I'm going very fast,
sir.
Right? Definitely, there is a time I will explain. Okay.
Okay,
no
sir.
Problem.
Sir, can you tell me, let me know the difference between product and product item?
Okay. So this is a product, this is a product item. Let's say you are a salesperson, you got a 5 t-shirt. We don't want to go over a lot of things. Just you bought a 5 t-shirt from the manufacturer. Okay. For that 5 t-shirt, we need to maintain only one product name. For that 5 t-shirt, we need to maintain only one product name. Okay. But that product, you have a 5 different items. Physically, it has a 5 different items, right? That 5 different items, you need to maintain the database table. That item, we are maintaining the product item table. You have a mobile. Each mobile have a one unique model. Right, that model, under that model they are going to manufacture several mobile, right? Each mobile is a one product item. That is called as, that is the difference between product and the product item. Product always one, that one product mapped with many product item, that based on the how many product you bought from the particular manufacturer. If I bought the 10 product 10 different 10 product of a t-shirt, I need to maintain 10 product item inside a product item, inside a product item table. For the 10 product item, one product available in the product table. Clear?
Yes, sir. Understood. Yes. Thanks.
Really clear?
Yes.
How about others?
Yes, clear, sir.
Okay.
There's one doubt. Purchase order is placed. We don't need a customer detail, is it?
Purchase order, come again, the question.
In purchase order, there is no customer details. Right?
Custom purchase order is a vendor. Whenever you buy a product from there, you want to sell some product. Okay, for that you are going to the manufacturer, buy some product which you want to sell. That manufacturer is called as a vendor. He is not a customer. Customer is who is getting a sales to you. Who is buying the product to you? If you are
Then customer order is we storing customer order in which table, sir?
Customer data we are storing in customer table.
No, order for customer.
Oh, order for customer. That is in the biller table. Biller and the payment table. There is no order table. I make it as a biller and the payment. Whenever customer buys some product, that each product item stored in the payment table. Okay, let's say you purchasing three different product item. That three different product item stored in the payment table for consolidate total information, bill number, everything stored in biller table.
Okay.
So sir, basically what I understood, like we have like three main components, like the owner, the vendor and the customers, right? So for all these peoples we are storing, so for owner we have when we are like creating a owner, the owner details are entered to customer user table. Only user table, or there is some other table where it is going?
One minute, I will draw the picture. Okay, for the
yeah, that would be better.
There is a one table called user table. We don't have to think about the columns now, okay? User table. Then under this, this is a separate design, okay? Then okay, this is the design. Initially I go with like this. User, it is there. Now also it is there. User, there is a user table. That user table is a parent table. That user table mapped with a three different table: employee table, vendor table, customer table. The reason I'm designed like this: employee, vendor, customer. Three people are a person, right? Three people are a person. It's a user. These three people having some common information. Those common information I maintaining inside a user table. Employee specific information I maintaining employee table. Vendor specific information I maintaining vendor table. Customer specific information I maintaining customer table. Okay. Then the user, the organization mapped with the user table. Whenever you create an organization, one user will create the user table. Okay, that user consider as a owner of that organization. Okay, this is separate. This is the DB model I have used in the billing system. You can create employee also, you can create vendor also, you can create customer also. As of now, I don't want to create multiple employee. Since it's a single user system, I don't want to create multiple employee. I want to create only one organization. That user will manipulate the all the billing system API. But now we have feasibility to create a multiple employee. I am not restricting that validation. I am not still adding that validation. If you want, you can create a employee, you can create a vendor, you can create a customer. Okay. Also, you can create a one owner. This many type of user you can create. When you look at here, employee. This is the employee request body. Through this, you can create a employees. Through this, you can create an employees. Then customer. Through this, you can create a customer by passing only mobile number. Then vendor. Through this vendor object, you can create a vendor. So we can create for each user type, we have separate endpoint to create that. As of now, I'm not, functionality is there, but as of now, I don't want to focus this. I want to project this as a only single user application. Okay. When you look at here some code, when you look at your code, I can't explain all the code here. Whenever login, this is a login scenario, okay? Whenever the login as a person, that person must be super admin or role employee. Either two can login. Customer role and a vendor role cannot be login. This is the code, this is the load by username will do. This part of authentication. Okay, you got this now? Any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay. Sorry. So when you look at here, this is the page where I can see, you can see Spring Boot features in billing system. The following 15 different features I have implemented the billing system. One is a normal dependency injection like service, component, autoware, lot of annotation I used. Then REST API, then validation framework, then exception handling. These are the features that I implement the billing system. I'll go and explain one by one. Okay. I think you people are already know some knowledge about what is a service component, what is a component annotation, what is the service annotation, what is autoware. Do you have any idea what is difference between add service, add component?
At the service we use for writing the business logic where all the transaction management are taken care.
Yeah. Add component.
And for the component, if you are writing a normal class, we can use a component so that you can reuse whenever required.
Okay, so technically, do you see any difference technically between SAT service and card component?
At the component, the transaction management does not happen.
It will be registered in IOC container.
Okay, I think the from my knowledge, right, I don't see any difference between at service and at component technically, but when you write a code, the standing perspective, there is a difference. See, in the all the service class, right, all the service class, whatever you told is correct. Okay, all the service class I'm using at service, all the service class I'm using at service. Then when you come to some class, say there is a common, and the common there is a tax calculation. This particular code I am using multiple places. I don't want to write a tax calculation for each and every time. I want to write one generic code, tax calculation. I want to reuse this code to across the application wherever I want to calculate the tax. This class I make it as a component. Under service package, all class as a service class. Similarly, there is a JWT request filter. This is the one class. This class I make it as a component class. Because why? Because this class also, this class, the purpose of this class is it act as a gateway. Whenever user send a request, it will get the token. See here, authorization, HTTP server request or get header, then authorization. Whatever data I am passing here, whatever data I am passing here. This is a header authorization, right? This is authorization header. I'm taking the token here. I take the token here. Then I'm validating the token here if it is valid or not. If it is valid, I'll go to allow further manipulation of the particular REST endpoint. The server return the proper response. That is the code. This is a filter class. This filter class each and every time invoke whenever you request something to the server. This class acts as a component class. Under this class act as a component class. Okay, whatever tax calculation I'm doing, this act as a component class. Then the service, all class act as a service class. When you look at this service class, go to inside a service. Go to inside a service. This service itself act as a component. The service class annotation itself act as a component. Okay. So that meaning, my understanding is the service and the component, there is no difference. Technically, there is no difference. But when you use this, the service annotation, component annotation, we need to use properly according to the coding standard. For example, let's say, I will show that architectural diagram. See, here's a presentation layer, service layer, DOA layer, right? Now, whenever you send a request, the request will go to the service layer. Let's say I want to create a new customer. The customer request go here, the service layer. Service layer capture the all the data from the request. The customer service will do the customer registration. Like that, employee service do the employee registration. Like this, product service create a product. Product item service create a product. So each service, if you say any service layer, that service layer, sorry, if you say any class as a service component, that service, that particular class use for particular flow, use for particular flow only, not for entire application. If any class act as a component class, that particular component class will act, that component class used by across the project, that used in presentation layer, that used in service layer, even that used in DAO layer. So if any class, you are implementing some logic, that logic need to use across the application, better we can go with at component. For example, I want to print current date. I want to print total number of item. This is the best example. I want to print a current date for all the scenarios. That particular class, particular logic rated class act as a component class. Now, if you want to work with some flow, that related class, we need to annotate with at service class, at service annotation. So whenever you write a code, that we need to decide based on your implementation that should add component or add service. But technically, I don't see any difference between at component and at service, because when you look at the service annotation, that service annotation itself using a at component. In the component, we don't have anything like that. Okay. Then, okay, this is what I want to explain. You know, AutoWide. AutoWide is after using service and the component, we can register. We can register a particular Java class in an IOC container. After registering, I want to use that particular Java class. Then we need to use AutoWide. Using AutoWide, you can use that particular Java component from the IOC container, which is registered using at service or at component. Okay. Then anybody tell what is the REST API? Do you have any idea what is the definition of REST API? Why we are called as a REST API, sir? Hello?
Yeah.
What is that REST API? Why is called as a representational state transfer? We are called as a representational state transfer, right? Why this specifically they are saying like that? These are fundamental information, because some people are not that much experienced. They can understand why we are calling it as a REST API.
Yeah. So any HTTP request when you are sending and getting a response, that we can say as a REST API code.
Yeah. Correct. So why they're using as a representational transfer meaning, let's say this is a client one, client two, client three. This client one can be a mobile device, client two can be a browser, client three can be a postman, whatever it is. Okay. They're sending a request to one form. That is a JSON form or XML form, right? XML form. But the client can understand only JSON data or a XML data or some other data format only. Client really don't understand what is the format of data inside a server. Okay, if it is Java server, we are using Java object. All data state we are maintaining inside a Java object, right? If it is some other server, some other object we are going to maintain, in case PHP or .NET. We'll talk about only Java. The client one going to send the request to the server. This server implemented Spring Boot application. This client one wanted to retrieve customer one data. Let's say this is a Java object 2 is a customer one. Here is sending the customer one. It will going there. Server send that to customer one, retrieve the data from the customer table. Then that customer table now inside the server in the form of Java object. In the form of Java object, customer data available in the server side. That is whatever data held by this Java object 2, that Java object 2 contains some customer data. That is customer number one, customer name is Suresh. Okay. Now the Java object to maintain in the customer data. That data is called as a state. That data is called as a state, right? That data we need to convert client representational state. We need to convert client representational state. That is the reason we are calling as a representational state transfer. Whatever state we are maintaining the server, we need to convert that state into client understandable format. So we are calling it as a this API as a representational state transfer. That is my understanding. Like that, all the servers. Do you have 5 minutes? I want to talk one more thing about apart from this session. Huh?
Yeah, yes.
Everybody,
yes,
okay, right?
Oh, yes, sir. Okay.
Yes, sir. See, actually, this 5 days program is only the project understanding, project functional understanding, the project. Then whatever Spring Boot feature I am using, that I am going to explain. You can end of the Friday. You can definitely understand how to deploy this building system. Then what is the functionality, how to play with that various REST endpoint, how that flow is happening, which class, what is doing. This information definitely you can understand. You can even if you can explain that much capable you will have the end of the this Friday. Okay, but if you want to master, if you want to master Spring Boot and the microservices, I am planning to take a class in the, from the next week onwards. Date not decided. Okay, if anyone willing to join this program, definitely you can join. It's a 30 days program. Also, it's a very reasonable cost. I am not charging way too much. Okay, see, this is a daily 1.5 hours to 2 hours program. The first, you can see here, 16 total 17 topics. I'm taking the Spring Boot topics. Spring Boot introduction, IOC container, what is startup project, then various annotations, then first REST publication, what is a validation framework, what is the exception handling, then JPA, then what is the standards we need to follow if you want to work with REST API, then what is content negotiation, then Richardson maturity model, then how to handle the property file, YAML file, how to load your customer YAML file, how to load your property files, then what is Swagger, what we can do with Swagger, then filters, then interceptor, then how to create a logging framework, then what is Hetios, hypermedia as an engine of application state, what is Hetios, then AOP, then how to manage Spring Boot profile. This part of the Spring Boot topics. Once you complete this particular topic, right, you are familiar with the Spring Boot, technically you must be familiar with that Spring Boot. Then we need to focus on microservices. These are the microservice topics. How to set up a config server, how to set up a naming server, how to set up a API gateway, what is a Zool proxy, then how to manage logging. See, this logging is a different. So this logging, there is a one more topic here, a Spring Boot logging framework, right? But that logging framework, we need to maintain multiple services. How to manage that? That is called as a Zipkin sleuth. Then load balancing. How to manage multiple server using ribbon load balancing. Then faint client. What is faint client? How to communicate? We have microservice means multiple Spring Boot applications, right? How to communicate easily? How to communicate easily one service to another service? Then fault tolerance. If any service is down, how to manage that? See, this is the microservice component. Once you come to the microservices, there is a testing framework, Marketo. How to test layer by layer. I don't want to test presentation layer. I want to test only presentation layer. I want to test only service layer. I want to test only database layer. How to do that? We can achieve it through Marketo. We can achieve it through WebMEC. Then how to test the entire thing, end-to-end test. That is Spring Boot integration test. Finally, I'm saying giving the Docker as a bonus. Okay, this Docker, nowadays all the companies using a Docker, right? They are deploying their microservice inside a Docker container. Even they are deploying database, everything in the Docker. Each Docker container having a one particular service. If you have three services, each service run in the Docker container. From the Docker container, each microservice communicate each other. How to do that? Those things we can see. This is a complete package. This is a complete package, not only Spring Boot. If you complete this, you will be a good microservice developer, not a Spring Boot developer. If you're a good microservice developer, you will have a good mindset. You must have a proper confidence in your mind to attend the interviews to get the job. Once we complete it, you will have. See, whenever cover this particular microservice, right? We are going to use Hello World program. How to implement these microservices using a Hello World program. Okay, very simply, only focus on technical. We don't want to focus on functionality, okay, billing system. Only the Hello World program, what is a config server, what is naming server. Using Hello World program, we can implement that. Once we done that, we will convert. Once we done that, we will convert that Hello World program as a billing system. As a microservice project, okay, whatever microservice project we have, that is a monolithic application, we'll convert that as a microservice. End of the day, after 30 days, you will have this kind of environment in your local machine. Okay, it's an API gateway, you have product service, account service, reporting service, then these services managed by discovery service. All service configuration will be coming from config service. Config service detail available in the Git repository. This kind of environment, end of the day, you can deploy in your local machine. interested people can join this program. Okay, huh?
Sir, for Spring Boot, like you'll be explaining this building system project only, right? So using, you know, what are all the things?
Yeah, definitely. In the end of the day, you'll be comfortable with this building system detailing, definitely. Using that only, I'll going to explain everything.
Okay. For micro services, you are just using like Hello World, you know,
separate, you know. Not like that. While teaching the Hello World, while teaching the micro service, I'll use the Hello World program. Okay. After completion of that, we will convert our building system as a microservice based environment. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, sir.
Okay, please let me know if you are interested. I'm planning to start the next week. Okay. Let me know. This cost is I'm planning to charge only 5,000. Okay, only 5,000, not much. If you I think in the outside they're charging a lot, I think. So tomorrow we're going to see day three, nothing but what are all the Spring Boot features I implemented the billing system. We're going to walk through all the technical, for example, let's say the Swagger. In order to implement Swagger, what is the step? And the exception handling. In order to implement exception handling, what is the step you need to follow? These steps we're going to see tomorrow. Okay. Huh? Thanks, guys, for staying.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you so much.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.